A man who did love her too, Dickie Arbiter, worked with her as the Queen's press secretary from 1988 to 2000.
And he joins us now live from London. Dickie, I know it is a difficult day for everyone in the UK and around the world, and for you personally, you're very close.
It is difficult, but one's got to be pragmatic. The Queen was incredibly pragmatic. And it's interesting, isn't it? Prince Philip died on the 9th of April 2021. The Queen died today, the 9th of September 2022, 17 months later. I don't think she ever really recovered from the loss of Prince Philip. He was her liege man for 73 years. And when you've lived that long with somebody, depended on them, depended on each other, it was a tremendous loss. We saw this lonely figure sitting, because of social distancing during the COVID epidemic, of sitting alone at the time of his funeral. She did cut a lonely figure. We've seen her gradually, unfortunately, deteriorate, getting very frail, having mobility issues. And we saw that delightful picture a couple of days ago, 48 hours ago, of her meeting her 15th Prime Minister, Liz Truss. What a difference 48 hours makes.
Dickie, I wonder if you can shed any light on what just happened in the last couple of hours, and also just the process of what will be taking place behind closed doors. Let's start with just what happened, first of all, with who was around her as she passed.
Well, in the last few hours of her life, the doctors were there, and the statement was released just before lunch today, saying there were concerns for her health, and although she was comfortable. It was that that triggered the family descending on Balmoral. King Charles III and Queen Camilla were really just down the road at Burke Hall, which is his Scottish home, given to him by his late grandmother, Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, who died in 2002. So he would have rushed there pretty quickly. The rest of the family would have headed towards Northolt Airport, just outside of London, boarded a plane to Aberdeen's Dyce Airport, and then an hour's drive from there. What is quite interesting, and I find extraordinary, that Prince Harry wasn't on the same aircraft and making his own way there. And probably arrived, if indeed he has arrived, after the death of his grandmother, which is very sad in the circumstances. What will be happening now? Well, there is a very clear, laid out funeral plan. It was written years ago. When I was at Buckingham Palace from 1988 to 2000, I had a hand of rewriting some of it, sort of modernizing it. And it would have been approved by late Queen Elizabeth II. So that'll be putting into operation by the Lord Chamberlain's office at Buckingham Palace. There will be the next 24 hours. Her coffin will stay at Balmoral in order to give estate workers and locals an opportunity of bidding farewell to their boss, after which it will then come down south to London and will probably go to either Buckingham Palace or Windsor Castle, the respective throne rooms, where it'll stay for about 3 or 4 days before moving to Westminster Hall for the lying in state, where the public will be able to file past and pay their respects before the ninth day, when the coffin will be taken to Westminster Abbey for the funeral service, and thence on to St George's Chapel, Windsor Castle, for the interment. So it's a very lengthy period, a very long period, and a very sad period when people will be able to express their emotions, whatever way. I believe that Australians will be doing the same. She'll be sadly missed by Australians, by members of the Commonwealth. We've got to remember that her 21st birthday speech, if you remember that, "I declare before you all that my whole life, whether it be long or short, shall be devoted to you and the great imperial family to which we all belong." Mm. Well, we don't have an imperial family anymore, but we certainly do have a Commonwealth family. And the statement that she made, the whole of her life, meant the whole of her life until she drew last breath. And she remained Queen Elizabeth II until she drew last breath this afternoon at Balmoral Castle.
Beautiful words, Dickie.
It's and just that emotion that you say, I mean, that will be felt right around the world. And I know it was her Jubilee celebrations. Even then she signed off "Your Servant." And that was her, wasn't it? Right, as you say, until her very last breath, it was about service to her country. And she was that one constant over 7 decades of extreme change, that stability, and people use words like steadfast to describe her, which are quite old-fashioned words, but that was her, wasn't it?
Ali, you've said it all. It was about duty. It was about continuity. It was about commitment to the people. Who can forget those words that she uttered during the start of the COVID pandemic on the 5th of April 2020, in which she said, and you said earlier on, we will see our friends again. We will see our families again. We will meet again. Very stoic, very much for the people, very much person who gave confidence to the people. They looked to her. When there was a time of celebration, they went to Buckingham Palace, they looked to her. When it was time of tragedy, they looked to her. And who can forget the Platinum Jubilee, the appearances on the balcony after Trooping the Colour. She didn't go to it, but she appeared on the balcony to a roar of spectators, all the way from Buckingham Palace, all the way up to Trafalgar Square, almost a quarter of a mile. And then the Platinum Jubilee itself, when she appeared on the balcony. And that wonderful sequence, you mentioned the opening of the Olympic Games and the sequence with James Bond, but something that overtook that completely was that wonderful sequence with Paddington Bear and the drumming on the cup and saucer to the beat of the drums, "We Will Rock You," that got picked up by the Royal Marines drummers outside the palace. She was a wonderful woman, and people will remember for her commitment, her duty, her love of people, her love of the Commonwealth, her love of Australia, of the realm states. Nobody can forget that, and nobody can take that away.
Well said again, Dickie. I wonder if you can also just elaborate a little on just how this all happens. Obviously, King Charles III is now the reigning monarch, but how does that happen after she passed? And what is the order of events there?
Well, there's a tradition. There were complaints, for example, at the time of the death of Diana, Princess of Wales, there wasn't a flag flying at half mast. Now, when Queen Victoria moved in there in 1837, the only flag that ever flew was the Royal Standard. And there was never any other flag. So when the sovereign wasn't in residence, the Royal Standard came down and the flag wasn't replaced. The sovereign never dies. We have the Queen's death today. The Queen is dead. Long live the King. When the King died in February 1952, the King is dead. Long live the King. So it's a smooth segue transition from one reign to the next. Yes, he will be proclaimed from St. James's Palace tomorrow and throughout the land, but he does automatically become king, because that is how the monarchy works in the UK and has worked for over 1,000 years.
So it passes immediately and it almost passes invisibly, doesn't it? But then, I mean, you knew Charles, or you know Charles. I mean, behind closed doors, yes, he's lost his mother. But to now step into those shoes and to be the reigning monarch, and I mean, I think he's the oldest heir apparent, or the longest serving heir apparent, and he becomes the oldest king at 73. What would be happening and the discussions he'd be having and feeling?
Well, he will realise, I mean, he's known his destiny since the day he was born, or the day that he was able to understand what his destiny was all about. He will be devastated by the loss of his mother. He's just kind of got over the loss of his father last year, and now 17 months later, his mother has died. He was very close to her, despite what various reports have come out over the intervening years. He will feel that she's a very hard act to follow. She was very pragmatic. She was very straight. She wasn't involved politically, but she was able to have her weekly audiences with prime ministers, 15 of them. Well, Liz Truss never had an audience, but she did have a meeting when she was appointed and kissed hands 2 days ago. But she was able to have these meetings with prime ministers, knowing that whatever was discussed, nothing went beyond the four walls of her audience room. And as far as the people were concerned, she was a queen of the people. You mentioned earlier about the walkabout. She invented the modern walkabout. Let's not move away from King George V and Queen Mary, who actually invented the walkabout during the First World War. They visited troops convalescing in hospitals. They visited various areas that were bombed by the Axis powers. So they invented the walkabout, but the Queen very much invented the modern walkabout, and people were appreciative of that. To actually have the Queen stop and talk to them, that had never happened before. And it was innovative for the Queen to suddenly be in immediate contact with the people that she was reigning over. And that was quite a move forward. When her mother died, and the Queen has always evolved during the course of the reign, she always used to wear sort of floral print dresses, rather dowdy, I think most people would say. But when her mother died, she suddenly transformed into bright colours. She always said, "I have to be seen to be believed." And my goodness, when she transformed after the death of her mother into emerald green, turquoise blue, cerise red, canary yellow, you could see her from the moon. So she really was seen to be believed. She will be desperately missed, not just by the people of the United Kingdom. She'll be missed by the realm states, which Australia is one of them, and I'm sure many Australians will miss. Yes, there is a Republican undercurrent there. There's a Republican undercurrent here in the UK, but people will miss her. People will miss her at the Commonwealth. They've already missed her at the Commonwealth Heads of Government meetings, of which Prince King George III, King Charles III now presides over. So she will be a figure that's missed. She's been around on the throne for 70 years. She's met every president of the United States except LBJ. She never got to meet him. She's met every world leader. Some of them have died years ago. Some of them are not. I mean, Gorbachev was probably the last world leader she met, who died only last week. So she will be sadly missed. And the king will find it a very hard act to follow, but he will do things differently, because we know, we being the globe knows, his thinking on climate change, his thinking on the environment, on education, all sorts of issues. He'll have to rein in, because he can't voice opinions as king in much the same way as he did as Prince of Wales, but we already know what his opinions are. And these opinions will then be taken up by Prince William, Duke of Cambridge, who will ultimately, in the fullness of time, become the next Prince of Wales.
Dickie, we're looking now at live shots outside Buckingham Palace. It's hard to fathom a more universally loved leader. You're going to see a huge outpouring of emotion there. You're saying that the Balmoral may not lend itself to such an outpouring of grief and celebration of life. But in the next couple of hours, I suppose the King will make some address of some kind. He's already released a statement, a very pointed and quite emotional statement. But it's hard to fathom them not actually coming and doing something, or maybe it's tomorrow. But either way, there's going to be tens of thousands of people around the clock outside Buckingham Palace now. As I said before, this woman was loved.
He will make a statement, ultimately. I'm not sure what broadcast crews are up at Balmoral. I'm sure they've all scrambled up there. So there will be something coming from him. But I think for the time being, he needs to be left alone in his grief. And in the fullness of time, probably tomorrow or even the next day, he will come out and he will say something, because he's very good in front of the camera. He's very good at doing pieces to camera, as his mother was. And he will want people to know about her last hours, about him, and about his reign. He might not give much away, but he will come out and say something. It is a difficult time, particularly when, as I said earlier, you've lost your father in April 2021 and your mother in September 2022. To lose two parents in the space of 17 months is very hard for any family, irrespective of what your age is. And Charles is 73, going to be 74 in November. But yes, we will hear from him, because he knows that he's got to say something. And he won't be backwards in coming forwards in doing that.
Dickie, I did notice too that as the people gathered to mourn the passing of the Queen outside Buckingham Palace, a rainbow appeared, which I don't know, I just think that's something that's just a quite lovely thing to note. But it was the BBC, it was 3:32 a.m. our time, which announced the passing of the Queen. Do we know, because it did seem to happen so quickly, do we know if her family made it in time to say their farewells?
The majority of the family did make it. I'm not sure whether Prince Harry made it because he decided to go under independent means while the rest of the family got on a plane at Northolt. The King and the Queen were at Burke Hall, which is just down the road from Balmoral, so they were able to get there pretty early once the bulletin had been issued, and probably even before, because they would have been called by the private secretary, Sir Edward Young, that the doctor's about to issue a statement and he should get over there, and he would have got over there. The rest of the family arrived in the course of the afternoon. The Duke of Cambridge came alone because the Duchess stayed behind because her children's first day at school. Which nobody would begrudge that. The Earl and Countess of Wessex were also on the flight. Princess Anne was already up there, as was the Duke of York. So Prince Harry, I'm not sure whether he's arrived. He was going independently. That remains to be seen. A great pity that he didn't make it before the death of his grandmother. That would have been the right gesture. But, you know, who knows the way they operate.
You mentioned Camilla then. Obviously, King Charles, you mentioned that she's Queen Consort. You also said, how will she be referred to? And just take us inside her life now.
Well, she would be referred to by her name. Her name is Camilla. She'll be referred to as Queen Camilla in much the same way as in the reign before the Queen, it was King George VI and Queen Elizabeth. So in this reign, new reign now, it'll be King Charles III and Queen Camilla. Oh. That's how she'll be referred to. She'll be very good. She's been terrific when Charles was Prince of Wales in supporting him and encouraging him, in reining him in when he sort of looked as though he was losing it, which not very often. She's very good with people. When she talks to somebody, she gives them quality time. She looks at them, she looks them in the eye and talks to them, not over their shoulder, to see who might be more important. But she does give the individual quality time before moving on. She's very good at charity work. She's very good at osteoporosis, which her mother died of. And she's been very innovative in children's literature, in getting children to read books, and even got an Instagram site in which she reads books in the hope that children are going to follow suit. So she is going to be a tremendous support to King Charles. She's going to be tremendous support to the country. And I think they'll do a terrific job. As I said a moment ago, a hard act to follow, Queen Elizabeth II, but in their own way, they will do it. Mm.
Dickie, can I ask you, when did you realise that there was something seriously wrong and that she had perhaps passed? Because it's very rare for her doctors to release any medical information about the Queen. They always keep that very quiet. So when they did that earlier today to say that she was comfortable but had taken a turn, was that at that point it was very clear that that she had passed or was going to?
I'm sorry to have to say this and admit to this, but when the mobility episodes were first announced at the end of last year, I had a sneaky suspicion that the Queen would not last 2022. We've seen her come back and forth. She did quite a few things over Christmas while she was up at Sandringham, and she looked terrific. And then she did a few things after Christmas. She missed the service at St. George's Chapel at Easter, something that she never missed before. She was at Prince Philip's funeral, which was a very sad occasion for her. But every time we'd seen her, she looked to be becoming frailer and frailer. And there's only so much a body can take. And then we got increasing mobility episodes where, yes, she was going to do something and then pulling out at the last moment. Prince Philip's Thanksgiving service comes to mind. Various other engagements. Remembrance Day, something that she never pulled out of. She was always there because she was the last serving head of state, the only serving head of state who actually served in the military during World War II, albeit in the ATS. So there were things that were actually booked for her to do, but she pulled out at the last moment, much to the disappointment of a lot of people, more so disappointment to her that she wasn't able to do it. And every time we saw her, and particularly the last time we saw her, which was a couple of days ago when she met Liz Truss and asked her to form a government, she looked very, very frail. You mentioned earlier her hands were blue. That's as a result of the lack of oxygen, the right oxygen getting into the bloodstream. And it was very, very noticeable. But she did look frail. And anybody who had any doubts would have wondered then. It's not a case of if, but when. And she never really recovered, did she? She cancelled the Privy Purse, cancelled the Privy Council meeting. At that meeting, the new cabinet ministers would have been sworn into their jobs. That was cancelled. And then today, the medics announced that there was grave concern. And as soon as they use words like grave concern, you know that something is seriously wrong. Yeah. And they weren't wrong. They were right. And this afternoon came the news that she had died peacefully.